Years ago, in a blaze of hype and outrage, Frankie Goes to Hollywood burst onto a lackluster music scene with the sex anthem Relax. Banned by Radio 1 for its obscene lyrics, the song went straight to number one, where it stayed for 5 weeks.
I mean, I can't understand why it sort of went through the roof like it did, but I don't, maybe just sex on television, gay men on television, gay men being out, I mean, having a good time, not really saying sorry for it either. You know what I mean? Just this whole hedonism thing. And I don't think people really kind of are too cool about hedonism. I mean, this that kind of sin thing comes in. You're not meant to have such a good time.
The second single, Two Tribes, sold 500,000, went gold and hit number one, all in the first week of release. And Frankie were plagued by press allegations that producer Trevor Horn and marketing mogul Paul Morley were the real force behind the band. However, 2 years earlier, the act and their songs had basically been the same. This previously unseen footage shows the band in 1982 when, despite performing their subsequent hits, they were turned down by all the major record companies. Trevor Horn and Paul Morley may have been the first to recognise their potential, but the band already had the songs and the showmanship.
The mastermind. I'd definitely say it was Holly, because it was his kind of, his vision at that moment, and he was writing some kind of some nice little lyrics and some dirty little ditties, you know what I'm saying?
There was no sort of mastermind behind it. I think it just happened.
It wasn't all Trevor Horn, and it wasn't all us, and it wasn't all Paul Morley. It was just a real good, you know, mix of everything.
I think Paul Morley was a help and a hindrance. I certainly helped at the beginning.
Paul Morley certainly brought Frankie into the public eye, with his range of slogan t-shirts being worn by 1 in 6 13 to 17 year olds in June 1984. Musically, Trevor Horn's pioneering of 12-inch singles and endless remixes kept Frankie constantly in the charts, culminating in their debut album, Welcome to the Pleasure Dome, which went straight to number one, and their third successive number one single, The Power of Love. The marketing machine was beginning to spin out of control. The tabloid press had been encouraged to play up the band's gay image, which began to get tiresome for the straight members.
A lot of the press sort of wrote gay band, which, when you're not gay and you live in Liverpool and you're hanging around a load of, well, you can imagine what it's like.
Then the follow-up album, Liverpool, recorded at immense cost, flopped.
Just grew too fast, you know what I mean? Most bands get to do that over like a period of like, say, 5, 6, 7 years. And it was like, it was more like 5, 6, 7 months, you know what I mean? And suddenly we were there and, yeah, it was, we split up because of, it was us, not being able to deal with the whole thing. It was just like going.
In under 2 years, Frankie had come, conquered, and collapsed.
It's like, what's that thing that they say in Blade Runner? The brightest star shines half as long, kind of thing. It was a kind of a bit of a case of everything.
Relax, don't do it when you wanna come. Whoa.
Ultimately, Frankie was suffocated by the pressures and overkill created by their own hype machine. But the songs have lived on, and now, 10 years after its initial release, when all the scandal and controversy has been forgotten, Relax has been remixed and will be relaunched in September.
When you wanna go to it, relax, don't do it. When you wanna come, relax, don't do it. When you wanna go.
It's not a very real world to be in. But it's a good laugh.
So there was Frankie. I mean, what did you think you wanted to do when you first saw them? I mean, what things immediately had to be chopped out of their routine?
Absolutely nothing, actually. Just transform it into a commercial arena.
So what did you add?
It just made it realistic, in a sense, the way that you have to compete with the Blandies of the world. So therefore, you have to do something, in a sense, that it will come through. So the test was to make it still sexy, ridiculous, randy, horny, perverse, tied up and bonded, all that rubbish, and still get to number one in the chart.
I like the way you're speaking in capital letters now. That's kind of getting it across how exciting it was at the time.
Well, it was. It was all in capital letters. It was all bold. It was all exclamation marks. And that's kind of unusual in pop. In a way, what we had with Frankie Goes to Hollywood was the last vestiges of being able to transfer and transform something that was exciting through the media and through the music papers so that it actually made number one. That became more and more difficult because what happened with punk and then what happened when we did Frankie Goes to Hollywood is the recording industry learnt their lessons and they hate anything unpredictable happening, so they kind of batten everything down.
So why do you think Holly Johnson's career failed?
Because he wasn't very good.
Not at all?
No.
So, I mean, basically what the talent behind Frankie Goes to Hollywood you're saying was you and Trevor Horn?
No, it wasn't me. It was 90% Trevor Horn, it was 3% me and it was 7% the band. And Holly was great singing on that first album, but that was it. And I think some people should just accept that's all they can do. You know, why not? That's fantastic, isn't it, you know? The people then pretend they can go on through life. Well, I don't think that's necessarily true.
So how much money did you make out of Frankie? As much as the
band? £142,000. Mm-hmm. And I haven't paid the tax yet.
All right. I mean, what do you think Holly should have done when Frankie split up?
I'm giving up. Become a steward on the QE2.
That would have been nice.
Nice career.
So what do you think of the whole Frankie reissues?
The cash in, and it'll be another record on the charts, it'll come and go very quickly, and a few people might make a bit of money out of it.
Will you be making money out of it?
Not enough to pay off the tax bill that I still have from the £147,000 I earned originally.
All right, and I won't be making